all my people, and if you're watching live, check us out on YouTube or listening on your favorite podcast provider, you are most definitely my people. Welcome to another episode of Botched Bots and Chair Shots. I'm your host, a chef by trade and a mark by choice. I am the Will Gray, and it's anything goes. And I come to think of it tonight, you know, as I introduce my first guest, he is the co-host of the number one wrestling podcast on the Hub. He is the host of the Straight Talk podcast. He is the warden of my heart. He is the poppy Vince Delgado. Vince, this is the only episode you've ever been on Botched Bots and Chair Shots is Anything Goes.
No, I think I've done an Anything Goes in the past.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. This is the only type. Oh, yeah. Okay. I think this is the only type you've ever been on.
Oh, yeah. Well, I have a type, Will, and you're it, and Anything Goes is my kind of show, so that's why I had to be here. So that is home.
That is here. It's good to see you. Scows, I see you. Jax, you have to be here. Husky Rhodes in the house. Husky, it's good to Husky. See you, brother. And to the top right of your screen, he is the host of the Getcho Podcast. He is one of the core four for the number one horror podcast on the Hub. He is my favorite Filipino poppy. It's our boy, Jess. Jess, how are you, bro?
Yo, what it is? What's up? Can a player just get some love?
Man, I love you all the time, Jess. I'm looking forward to this because honestly, getting you and Vince together for 90 minutes, like what the hell could go wrong?
Hey, we're going to tag team you, Will. We're going to tag team you.
That's right. Jess, Daddy will.
Scissor me.
I'm starting to get jealous over here.
No, we got you, man. We got you.
Jackson,
listen, I'm a big guy. There's enough for me to go.
Right? Oh, yeah. Enough room. It's big boy season, man. It's big boy season.
It is big boy season. I'm taking applications.
In the middle of the top row, the meat and the boss bitch and Jess sandwich is the co-host of pretty much everything on every podcast network ever now because he works more than I do. He can rattle off his shows later. It's everybody's favorite Ginger Ninja. It's our boy Jax. Jax, how are you?
I'm doing fucking awesome tonight. I got the whole house to myself. I'm doing great. I'm in a great mood.
That's one of my favorite times is when you get that all to your lone time, and every man on the planet knows what I'm talking about. Like that nobody at home time. That's primo time right there. And every dude knows. Hang it loose.
I'll just say this. I don't have to use headphones for the next week.
Pretty much that shows everything that I was just talking about. That's good. What the fuck is this? What's up, Mateo? It's good to see you, bud. Oh shit. This is like when you
the warden.
Where is Benji? Benji didn't even respond to my message. He left me on red.
I don't think that was by design. The man had a hot day tonight. So we don't cock block on the Getcho podcast. So we let our boy do his thing so he can hang free. You know?
Shout out to Katie. Bree in the house. What's up, Bree? Thanks for stopping by. But perched upon her iron throne in the Boss Bitches corner is the Beyonce to my Hova, the Bonnie to my Clyde. She's the brains behind the operation. She's the Boss Bitch. Al, how are you?
I'm good. I'm rocking my new Undertaker shirt I got for my birthday.
Nice.
Happy belated birthday, Al.
My birthday is tomorrow.
Week in the house.
Week rude in the house.
Hey, the core week four rude. Is here the with core just four in the intact. Show.
The core four intact for Botched Bots. I feel loved. Even Dad Hat's here. What's up, y'all? Listening while doing inventory.
All right. Shout out.
For sure. Will AJ and Hoover, 38. Bells. Yeah.
All right.
What's up? This season of Big Brother's been wild, dude. It started off slow and then picked up. So, Al, did I ask how you were?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yes, Jay.
Coming fresh, man. Y'all always working. Sunday's a busy time for y'all. I'll be waiting anxiously for that to drop. See what's new in Nuckaby Buckingham Palace.
Were the black tank tops on display this week? That's what I want to know.
Shoulders out, guns out, suns out, or whatever the fuck it says.
Yeah. I think it's just realized, chins up, tits out. I think it's what it is.
Chins up, tits out, and watch for the shoe. Gentlemen. This is always the first half of an Anything Goes. I ask it every week, but this week we always put a little bit more emphasis into it. What has y'all pissed off for greatness in the world of pro wrestling? What has you the most worked up, good, bad, and different? I don't care who goes first. I will call a name if I have to.
The fact they're reporting that they might be adding new fucking titles to WWE has me pissed off. We don't need.
I have a little bit about that in the news and rumors.
Ooh, spicy! I love cheese, man.
We don't need a trios division in WWE.
No, now, we don't.
Like, could we use a women's mid-card title?
We've talked absolutely we could.
Yes, we can. That I'd be okay with. But if you add a six-man tag or a trios division, it's fucking pointless.
Yeah.
Was that what the report said? Was that a trios title was considered?
The report is, let me scroll to it in my news and rumors. All it says is they're discussing new title schemes following its merger with UFC. This includes new names, weight classes, trios, etc. Okay. That was reported by BWE.
I'm all for the cruiserweight. I even like the purple strap.
Love the purple strap cruiserweight titles. Before they could bring in a non-existent trios division, they should definitely add a women's mid-card title. I can agree with that.
Yeah.
For sure.
I don't think we need any more titles on WWE, you know? I think it's okay. I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to a women's mid-card, but... We don't need any more titles.
I would say I wouldn't be opposed to the idea of getting new tag titles because I think those have like overstayed their welcome. Either split them up and do like a specific title for SmackDown, specific tag titles from Raw, or just unify them and do the Roman thing and just have one unified title. Because the red and blue straps. I don't know, maybe make them purple for Judgment Day.
Maybe. Okay. And maybe not call them gold because they're silver and they look like nickels.
Can we put scissors on the back of them?
Only if they're gold for $5,000 checks.
$5,000 if you do that. When me and Jesse win the tag titles, we're putting scissors on the back of them bitches.
Hey, as long as our residue is on there, I'm good.
Our residue is going to be everywhere when you and I finally end up in the same room, bro.
Oh, my God.
Before can I watch? You're going to be there. Somebody has
lights
to
hold the camera. Lights are on.
Before I give Jess his go, because Vince has a couple on his list, Scows from off the top says, BWE needs to be taken with a mountain of salt, LOL. There's been a lot of debate recently online of the Boozer 666 or whatever his name is. He's a WWE insider that's inside the curtain, and apparently him and Sean Ross Sapp and a couple of the other dirt sheet aficionados have been going back and forth on Twitter. Sean says one thing, everybody else says something else. So you guys got any opinions on dirt sheets going after each other?
Mortal Kombat. Fatality. Yeah. Finish him. That's what I want to see.
Whoever is the last one left is the last dirt sheet, right?
Is the last dirt sheet. Look, I always ignore those.
I might have the smallest following. I would love hand-to-hand combat with a few of those motherfuckers. I'm not going to lie.
Alcatsutzer Dave can get some hands.
Yeah. You want to win this Mortal Kombat of dirt sheet riders? Call this guy. Because as soon as I drop my pants, ain't no one going to want a fat naked guy.
Dude, I can't. God, I would love to find a fat naked guy. As long as it's you, Jax.
I have to get with Jess because I don't know what aisle the Chris goes on, but I'm gonna need a whole stockpile of that shit.
Are you slinging the hammer like Shao Kahn in that fight, Jax?
Finish him.
More like the gavel.
Okay.
Oh, right.
Than a hammer.
Nice.
Okay.
More nice.
I like that a little bit more assertive. I like that.
A little bit more assertive. Not as crazy and flingy as he does.
Maybe like it'd be like Johnny Cage's shadow kick, shadow dick.
Yeah, shadow dicks.
Hey, there you go, shadow dick.
Just speaking of shadow dicks, what's up, Shadow? I want to see Jax with his pants down. He can be my Crisco Jericho and break my walls down. Oh yeah, God, that sounds hot.
I see it. I mean,
Jax, don't get his band, please. Jess, you got one for me?
Piss off or greatness? I mean, not too much, but if I had to choose one, it'd probably be the whole PWI discourse, and not really the top three, but about like the the bottom half, you know what I'm saying? I would say, like, some people think that Naito deserved to be on there. You know, Jax Alexander's on there. Mm-hmm. Cody, I think, dropped a couple of numbers. But, there's a criteria to follow. Mm-hmm. I don't really care. I mean, there's a bunch of people that are on. There's a bunch of new people that are on that have never been on. So I think people should look at that.
Malachi Black wasn't on the list.
Right. Malachi Black wasn't on the list.
But he was also out for a long time. Like, people have to understand, like, people have been out or they haven't been on TV. Like,
right.
You can't be judged if you're not on TV. Like, Cody was out forever.
Right. And then that's kind of like what I've been saying, too, because Josh Alexander was also out and he made the list. And Naito was almost out the same amount of time. So I think it's just the certain cutoff periods are kind of like shaky. But, you know, what can you do? I mean, a lot of people have been on the list before. So, like I said, a lot of new people are on the list. So I think that's how I look at it.
We love you, JJ.
JJ.
Happy early birthday, JJ. Shout out.
Birthday twin.
No, I pretty much agree with that. Dad Hat dropped in and said he hasn't pissed off for greatness. People bitching about Cody, who won't get to finish the story because The Rock made an appearance. Do you guys think The Rock showing up will get to him in news and rumors?
Okay. I think the best thing about people complaining about that is that there's been memes been made about Cody Rhodes doing his pipe bomb. And he's like, trust me, this isn't sour grapes. But the fact that Dwayne is in the WrestleMania, main event of WrestleMania next year, and I'm not, makes me sick. The exact same words the Punk uttered on the pipe bomb. I think that's funny. I don't know if he'll get to finish his story. We'll see. I mean, at this point, it's like, it's fucking wrestling. Just fucking watch the story. Stop complaining about it. It be what it be. The Rock may only just make this one appearance and that's it. You know, just because he cock teased us on the Pat McAfee show doesn't mean he's actually going to be at WrestleMania, you know?
Right.
So let's see how shit boils over, you know? And to go off of what Just was saying, like, the PWI list, you know, like, it's tough to, like, get 500 of the best wrestlers across the whole globe and, like, have everyone agree on the rankings. They have their cutoffs. They have their criteria. We had Kristen Ashley on the SmackDraw podcast this time last year to talk about the PWI 150 as well. So for the women, so it's a tough process. I will say I do love the fact that those Shield boys are top three.
If you don't already, Dad Hat, drop the WC Wreckage pod info in the chat for me so I can pin it and highlight it for us. All the free shout outs there. I love that podcast. It's one of my favorite projects.
That was a fun one. The Bret Hart one. That was,
yeah. Bret Hart and WCW. That was a great episode. That was a like hella fun. Vince, you said you had a couple. You want to go ahead and drop one off your list before me and Al go, and then we'll come back to you.
Sure. Sure. I always like to like come back for seconds. I'm not just talking about food there. I'm pissed. What pisses me off is the people shitting on Becky for like taking it, winning the NXT Women's title on Tuesday and beating Tiffany Stratton, saying, oh, they're burying Tiffany. They're ruining Tiffany. They're just giving shit to the horsewomen. And I'm like, look, whether it's Charlotte, whether it's Becky, whether it's Bayley or Mercedes, these women are good wrestlers. They're doing things. Like, she's going to be in NXT. Like, this is only going to help Tiffany Stratton. I didn't hear people bitch and moan and complain with Dolph Ziggler beat Braun Breaker for the NXT World Championship. And then he ended up putting Braun over. And that worked out because Braun had a match on Raw where he won the NXT title. They talked about it on SmackDown last night, even though I wasn't able to be on the show. Matt mentioned how Rhea lost her NXT Women's title to Charlotte, and they were able to, like, go back to that story narrative, and then when she beat Charlotte at this past WrestleMania, it meant that much more than just like beating Charlotte for the title just because. So it's only going to help out Tiffany because she's in that same platform with Becky Lynch, who is one of the top five in the company. Despite me not liking her, I'm not a Becky apologist. You will not find me every week sitting here and defending Becky Lynch. But the fact that people are over here like hating on it, it's like it's she just won a title. She won the Grand Slam. She's gonna put over someone. If it's not Tiffany Stratton, someone has to take that title off of her. And whoever takes that title off of Becky is gonna be a big moment for that individual. It could be Roxanne. It could be Cora. It could be Gigi. Wendy Chu, could be Wendy Tiffany. Chu. Yeah. Wendy
Love
Chu.
Wendy Chu.
Dude, Wendy Chu's been sleeping in the backstage catering for like 3 months. We don't know where she's been. Like, she might wake up and get this title. So we don't know. Like, just
taking a nap.
Because yeah. I put her to sleep, that's why.
Ooh. Ooh. That good? That good, Jess?
Shout out. Big shout out to our boy Justin underscore Hill Tag.
Yo, my brother.
He does all G-Land. The intro music pretty much for all your favorite podcasts. Us, Vince, Getcho, Getting Off, Smacking It Raw, She Elite, pretty much everybody. Nerdy News at 420. Him and Al did fantastic work on that one. Make sure you're following our boy. If you need an intro music and a fantastic custom beat, check our boy out. All the free shout outs.
Yes.
AJ, we will definitely be touching base on Jade Cargill when we get into news and rumors.
You know that's going to happen.
Now, Rhea still has the belt, JJ. That didn't happen. And the New Day won the tag titles last year, too. What?
The NXT ones, right? Tag titles.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. Yeah. Perfect. Good job, AJ. Way to kick it back.
Thank you. I forgot that happened. See, people are going to forget Becky was NXT Women's Champion.
For all we know. That's fine, too.
Yeah, it'd be fine.
Well, I know a lot about wrestling, but I can't remember all 16 of Flair's title runs. You know what I mean? Like,
how dare you?
I know. That's
You've
what
let
saying.
Me down.
I've let you down.
How can Ow. I ever trust you?
What has you pissed off your greatness tonight in the world of pro wrestling?
So this is probably going to be an unpopular opinion.
Ooh. You with an unpopular opinion?
What is this, Nightbra?
I am tired of people shitting on Nia Jax. And I say this because she, in her off time, has worked really fucking hard. So I think that everyone should just come in with an open mind about her and see what she does in the ring. Like, give her a chance to prove that she has worked hard and gotten better. She's super loved in that locker room. It wasn't like, you know, she was a big person to come back. Like, they genuinely brought her back because she is loved in that locker room and she's worked super hard. Give her a chance.
Ooh, that's actually one of my pissed off for greatness. I should have started off with that one.
Okay, well, then you go off with it. Now that she said her piece, you come back with what has you pissed off with greatness about Nia Jax, and then I'll throw my two cents in, because I think I'm probably going to end up being between the two of you.
Perfect. My pissed off with greatness is the fact that they brought back Nia Jax.
Beautiful, Vince. Beautiful.
See, I had this already lined up as one of my first ones. I'm like, I wonder how Will and Allison stand on this. And then I started watching the stream from SmackDown Raw, and I saw Allison's comments. I'm like, oh, well, Allison's not on board with me. But let me go off anyway. Like I said, this is my personal opinion. I don't have any personal vendetta against Nia Jax personally. I just don't think she does anything for me, period. I don't think she's added much of anything in her career. She kind of is like a Ryback type of wrestler, where she was like this powerhouse or whatever. She's like Braun Strowman too. Like, they disappear or whatever, and you're not really going to miss them. Unfortunately, she does have a history of injuring women's wrestlers.
She does.
I don't want that to be a thing, especially with Kairi Sane supposedly rumored to come back. Maybe this is going to prevent Kairi from coming back. She's going to see Nia. She's going to be like, let me go back to Japan. But no, in all seriousness, it's like, I don't think she's adding much. I don't think she's going to add much in general. I don't think she's, like, whatever. If she does improve, all kudos. I'll give her the chance to improve. She can turn my opinion upside down and flip my narrative here. But as of right now, I don't think she adds anything. I don't think she's told any serious, interesting stories in the ring. She hasn't really accomplished anything of me. And that was from day one when she first debuted in NXT in her first match. I never cared for it. People were like, oh, she's so cool, yada, yada. She's like Awesome Kong. And I'm like, I don't care. I don't see any like novelty to her. But that's just my personal opinion.
Right.
I would hope that if she is back, it is because she's worked on her craft and is much better. I don't want to just like see anyone get hurt, period, unless their name is Matt Riddle. And aside from that, you know, like,
Ritter, that's over Riddle.
Yeah. Aside from that, yeah, that's kind of my whole thing with Nia Jax. It's like, I don't think she's really added anything. The most interesting thing she's done in her career for me was be in the Men's Rumble and get RKO'd by Randy Orton. Like, I thought that was, like, the coolest thing she's done.
Right. I mean, but this is an opportunity to give her that chance to, like, change her character and do better things. And maybe, you know, this new version of her you might like. Maybe.
We'll circle back in a few months' time, Allison, and we'll see. Like, I am open to change. I'm willing to try something more than once if in case I don't like it. So we'll see.
I'm in between you two on the fence posts here, I guess, because I'm not quite all team Yago Nia Jax with Al. I'm not quite there yet up here. Okay. But I'm also not like all the way over here where you're at too with the whole I'm mad that she's back thing. I think the women's division needs somebody who can bolster that roster. And as much as you don't like it, she is a viable veteran in the division. If she's taken the time to, you know, take the sandpaper to the rough edges that she had before, and she agreed that she had some stuff she could work on. She wasn't the say all be all of big women wrestling. I guess that would be the PC way to put that. Whatever, you know, like, she would be what we would consider a big man in the men's division. That's who she is in the women's division.
Yeah.
And as long as she came back, learned how to work safely as that person, then I'm here for it, because the women's division needs that menacing monster.
She has the potential to be like the Big Show for the Big Show type like role for that women's division, a Mark Henry type of character. But like I said, to me, she's more of a Ryback or more of a Tyrus.
Wow, dude. Not a chance, bro. That's a terrible way to put it.
Case yeah. is I also, could, oh, go ahead.
No, let Case, go. Yeah. Also, they need to actually use their women's division and the talent they actually have. That's the only grit I really have with Nia coming back. That's a great way to look at it, Katie. Mm. No way is that even close to the Ryback conversation. Is that what you mean, Scals? Poppy, cool. You're up there getting swole. You're going to get me all like hot and bothered in the produce department.
Well, man. Oh, well, I was just.
Yeah. So Scals agrees with me. She might be a little rough around the edges, but there's no way you're going to tell me Nia Jax runs the ropes the way Tyrus did at 75. Can I get a hell yeah?
I have never seen Tyrus run the ropes except for when he was Brodus Clay. So I will give you that. Jesus. All right. I'll rescind my Tyrus quote, but I still I compare her more to a Ryback as opposed to like a Mark Henry.
My thing with Nia Jax is like right now in the women's division on Raw, because that's where I think she's going to be, is there's too many faces for the women's division. So they need a straight out heel that nobody really wants to get behind. So what better to put in that position than Nia Jax? Will she like get the fans over? Probably, most likely, you know what I'm saying? But for right now, they need a super heel. So I think that's the reason why she got brought in.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like you could use Piper Niven in that role and you'd be much better served.
True. But I think a lot of people just love Doudrop. Piper Niven.
She can Doudrop me.
She can Doudrop the fuck whatever she wanted. I don't care.
But yeah. That's how I look at it. I'm kind of like in the middle, you know.
Well, in the middle. Yeah, I agree. Jax, where are you at with the Nia Jax stuff?
I'm kind of like, oh, cool, she's back. Okay.
Yeah, just kind of, let's move on. Here, let her do her thing. Let's see where it goes.
I personally called this at the Royal Rumble when she came back. I said she's back with WWE, and I think she's been working with them training-wise since the Rumble.
I would hope so.
But
yeah.
She's also, if you like, I've been getting, Will's been teaching me the Twitter and the Instagram stuff. So I've been looking and I follow a lot of these people, and she's been working out with people like Moose.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And Tamina working out with a lot of Impact stars.
Her and Charlotte worked out some together. They're super close friends.
Yes.
The two of them, despite, you know, in the past, like, they've had some issues backstage, but, like, now they are very close.
My home.
Yeah, they do a lot of stuff together. So.
I think she was a bridesmaid at Charlotte's wedding with Andrade. Yeah.
She was also a bridesmaid in Alexa Bliss's wedding and also Carmella's wedding.
You never heard any drama from Nia Jax. Like, Nia Jax backstage talking shit again.
Her and Charlotte had like a little beef for a little bit because I think Nia hurt her. at one point, but they like got over it, and now they're super close.
But but who's to say that that was actual beef instead of just two friends like having an argument? You know?
Yeah, you've had that with close friends. I've gotten into a spat with someone over a game of 21 in the back
backyard. Thank you. Thank you.
See, look, Vince gets it.
The heated Yu-Gi-Oh duo
can bring that out of you as well. You know, you never know.
It happens.
AJ's pissed off for greatness. I'm pissed off for greatness with Impact 1000. I'll use that as a segue for my pissed off for greatness, and then we'll see if anybody else has anything left. I think that cycled through everyone. You'll see what Vince has left on his plate. He always he understands the assignment when he comes on. But mine is Nick looking at Impact 1000 with Chris Sabin coming back. Oh, Lord. With Chris Sabin coming back in Impact and winning the X Division title. And what that means is that he got hurt and then he came back and we're right back in the same position we were 2 months ago. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Like all this did... Leo Rush having the title and transitioning for the last 2 months, all of that was just a holding pattern. So we can circle all the way back around to Chris Sabin getting the X Division title again, going after Alex Shelley and cashing in for options, seeing everything that goes into it. So I can't be mad at Chris for getting hurt, but my pissed off for greatness is that X Division pretty much got put on hold for 2 months. During the period he was down, because Leo Rush's title reign did nothing for the belt.
Leo Rush is an Impact.
Yeah, he was the X Division title champion. Yeah,
X champion.
He took it off of Chris Sabin at Slammiversary, and Jax was watching it with me, dude. I was so pissed, dude. I fucking was mad when he lost, because I was like, that was a bull. They squashed him in like 8 minutes. It was not even a 10-minute match on their biggest pay per view of the year.
Yeah, it was very, very quick, straight. Like, you got allotted 3 minutes. Go do this in two. Like, you could tell it was real rushed and like, go knock it out and get it done.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right.
Thanks for the follow, pew to the pew. Oh man,
that's pew name. Pew.
Awesome, man.
Pew to the pew. That's my sister. That's legitimately like my little sister Peanut.
Oh, is it? Oh. Shout out.
We were both pissed, Will. I know you were there with me too, Scouts. We were watching that show together. Love you, sister. That's awesome. Thanks for stopping by. Big shout out for the sister coming in. I think that's everybody. Vince, you got anything else on your page before we switch over to news and rumors?
It's a little minor. It's nothing that really pissed off too many people off for Graceness this week, but it pissed me off. And we're gonna go back to SmackDown here. And can we get some like fair treatment from my boys in the LWO, specifically Cruz del Toro and Joaquin Wilde? By the way, Joaquin Filipino. Bring this up. He's the Justin of that group.
Bring this up.
Listen. They finally had a tag match a few weeks back against KO and Sammy prior to Payback, and they got basically squashed just so that the champs can go over to be reminded that, yeah, they're a tag team, actually, and not just singles guys in the tag team. Then they come out, and they get basically beat by the Street Profits, then get beat up again, and then Ray takes just like a fucking shot to the face by Dawkins. Shout out to Dawkins, he looked fantastic. But it's like, man, my boys can't get shit. Like, the highest profile stuff they've done was like the Ray Dom match at Mania and then helping out Bad Bunny in Puerto Rico. And it's just like, it's a little frustrating because you want them to do something more with them, because I feel like they could do something more, especially Santos. Santos is someone that's greatly underutilized. And just like they did with Selena Vega in Puerto Rico, what was it, Backlash? They could do the same thing with her. Why don't put her in a program with EO? Like, do something with the women's division as well. It's like, I feel like if they're not doing something immediately to promote something Latino, they're not really being used. And on top of all of that, they do it on Mexican Independence
Day.
God damn it.
I was about to say.
The disrespect. I think that's what you were talking about when you're like, I hope Vince isn't going to be happy about this on Twitter.
Yeah, when they pretty much got squashed. Tommy, what's up, buddy? Jess, you want to lead off with the LWO stuff? I've got
I was just gonna say the same thing that Vince was gonna say. Like the day before, the day of Mexican Independence Day, they get squashed on SmackDown, and it's like, damn, can't they just get some love for at least at least this day, you know?
Facts. I agree. My two cents was, I understand the necessity to have mid-card guys. We've had people on the interviews talk about it. I've preached about it. Like, just because you're a mid-card wrestler isn't a slight. If there wasn't a mid-card, the main event wouldn't mean anything. True. Like, it doesn't mean that you're a bad wrestler because you do the job in the mid-card. You know what I mean? That also doesn't make you a jobber because you take a lot of losses either. Because I think everybody in the LWO, most importantly Santos, all of them have opportunities or will have the opportunity to have title reigns. I just don't think it's their time yet. They're still building and developing in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. Let them get their shine for a little bit. Let Ray drop to Santos. Let those tag titles kind of figure out what they're going to do, and then let the LWO have it. They're not those larger-than-life characters yet to bigger than the Judgment Day or the Bloodline or Sammy and KO.
No, but that's kind of like my big gripe about the tag titles is like they should split them up because they have so many great tag teams just on SmackDown alone. And it's a fair point that you're putting out there, Will, because like guys like the LWO, it's like, yeah, as much as I may like them or whatnot, they're not on the same tier level as the Judgment Day or the Bloodline or Kevin and Sammy, and they're not going to get on that level unless they get two separate titles. And that was the same issue we were having with Roman for about 2.5 years until the World Heavyweight title was introduced and crowned to Seth Rollins. Now we're seeing Shinsuke challenge for the title. We saw Finn challenge for the title. Heck,
fucking love Shin.
And Seth's even talking about giving Ricochet a title opportunity. He's not going to win it, but that's going to be a great highlight for Ricochet to be challenging for that world title. And it would have never happened if they never split up the titles and have two world titles. That's what they need to do with the tag division. My whole thing here is like Ray's just a transitional champion to get that title off of Theory and then on to Bobby Lashley. That's the only reason why they were jumped in a tag, because Lashley is going to be that second mid-card champion. He's going to be like the Gunther to the SmackDown for that U.S. title division, and that's how you build them up and build up this new faction with Bobby Lashley. I love Bobby Lashley, love the Street Profits, love this new Edge and this unit that they're building. But, you know, it sucks to see all my Mexican Latinos, all everyone out there isn't doing anything. And it kind of sucks.
Mm-hmm. Al, Jack, y'all got any to throw in on the LWO stuff?
They have really cool shirts.
They do have great gear. I love their gear and their merch. Yeah, I can agree.
His hat he was wearing was real nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, I really like it. I like to see them do more with them. Like, put them against Judgment Day. Like, I don't understand why we haven't gone back to the Ray Dom situation yet. Like, that just has kind of been
on the back burner.
Yeah.
Got a small tease when he was in the corner of Dragon Lee versus Dom in NXT. We got a little tease of that. Yeah. So that's the story that's never going to fully end, just like Kevin
until and Sammy. The retirement match.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's his retirement match.
Yeah, but like they should, I don't know. Like it was so good. I just really, and now that like Ray has a full faction behind him, it would be nice to see like the factions go at each other, because you can have Rhea and Zelina doing stuff. Like I'm tired of seeing Rhea, like even though she is the champion, she doesn't really wrestle a whole lot. Like they make her look like I've said this a few times now, like she looks like a glorified valet with a belt, because all she does is stand on the sidelines for Dom and Finn and Damien. It's like I need to see her like do stuff, just like I need to see LWO do stuff.
Exactly. I think the biggest thing I can compare this to is like the women division not getting a fair shake until Ronda showed up. They got their own pay-per-view and they got highlighted. The minute Ronda disappeared, they went back to being irrelevant in terms of the booking team. Same thing with LWO. They were built up highly because Bad Bunny was showing up and he was going to have a match against Damian Priest in Backlash in Puerto Rico. They were trying to sell some shirts. And then now Bad Bunny is gone. And then they're like, yeah, we'll bring you back like next time Bad Bunny shows up. And I feel that kind of feels like what it is like. You know?
Yeah. No, I can see the comparison.
Yeah.
All right, Al, we got through Pissed Off for Greatness. Now it's time I'm going to hand it off to you. It's time for News and Rumors. So it's your show for the next little bit. What you got for us?
So our opening segment, which I've now started doing, is our Ritter over Riddle moment of the week. Which is what I call any news that has to be said about Matt Riddle. So regarding Matt Riddle's absence from Raw, Dave Meltzer said on Wrestling Observer Radio that it was actually due to illness, specifically infections in both ears and a case of bronchitis, that he was not on Raw and not due to his incident at JFK on the way back from the Superstar Spectacle. He's expected to be out 3 to 6 weeks with the double ear infection and bronchitis.
Yeah, well, I mean, divorce will do that to you.
Jesus.
Yeah, Bray is in the... He's the leader of the LWO, JJ.
So, do we... I mean, do y'all think that he's, like, legitimately sick, or are they just trying to, like, not draw attention to his situation?
That could be part of it. I mean, that's a lot to... That's a lot of infections that happen at one time, though.
Those two things do kind of go hand in hand, though. It's like with the bronchitis, like the, you know, it backs up into your ears. Like a lot of times when I have bronchitis or sinus infections, I also get an ear infection because all the snot backed up
in my ears.
I get sinus infections too. But like, I don't know. I mean, it could be a little to derail his situation, but at the same time, it's like I'm not missing him. So,
yeah,
I mean, I'm cool. Yeah.
You know, when I was prone to sinus infections the most, when I was using a bunch of Coke. So it's probably, I mean, I'm just going to call a spade a spade.
Yeah.
I'm just saying it. I mean, I can connection. Say it.
I see the vision. That's what we want there.
That's all I got to say. If I could Ritter over Riddle all the time, 10 times out of 10.
In addition to that, WWE has not responded to any inquiries about Riddle in the wake of the incident. In light of that, Dave Meltzer wrote that Riddle's absence from Raw was noteworthy.
It just happens to be noteworthy because he was missing from Raw in this past week events because of the incident he had at the airport. So that's speculation on Dave's part, not necessarily like that's the reason. Like you mentioned, like he could have like bronchitis, ear infection, nose infection, whatever. He could just, you know, like have the flu. He could like just have a bad mental day, you know. Shit happens. I'm not here to defend Matt Riddle because it's always Matt Ritter over the other guy. I don't know. I don't really care. Like, I didn't really miss him on Raw. Like I said, I don't really care if he shows up or not. It does me no difference. So, yeah.
It's all accusations. Like Rick Ross said, false.
False. If the glove don't fit, you must acquit. There's a special term in journalism. If you speculate the news as being truth without calling it a speculation, do you know what that's called?
What?
That's called yellow journalism. Do you know who practices yellow journalism?
Dave Meltzer.
The fucking tabloids.
Yeah.
Yes. People who report stories that are speculated as being truth without anything to back their stories up. It's yellow journalism. That's what Meltzer does. Meltzer practices yellow journalism. He takes pieces of the truth and presents them as a whole truth in and of itself without anything to support his claim.
Right.
So, you know, I wouldn't say fuck Meltzer, but the past two media calls we've been on, it's been Will Gray and Dave Meltzer following Mr. Gray. That's all I've got to say.
In response to speculation, Vince McMahon was at Raw making... In response to speculation, Vince McMahon was making changes on what figures to be the on what was the last Raw produced under his ownership of WWE. Sean Rossap posted that Vince has not been physically present at Raw or SmackDown in months.
He had spinal surgery. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I feel like anytime something happens on Raw or SmackDown or a change has to be made that like the IWC doesn't like, they're meaning like Vince is back in creative. Well, no, maybe just shouldn't happen.
Right. That's the go-to argument to anything that sucks on WWE. It's always must like, oh, well, Vince. You know, Vince. Oh, it must be Vince. Oh, the Fed, blah, blah, blah. Like, you know, I just love the fact that everyone pretends to be smart with actually being dumb.
Yeah.
We said the bad word.
We said he who shall not be named, according to Rick.
See, and Nucky Buckingham Palace, like, Botchbots and Chair Shots, Ribbon City Radio, we're like Switzerland. We can talk about all things wrestling here. And it just, we'll tread lightly. Yeah, trying to make me twitch. Yeah. I know, bro. We love you. We love you, Greek. Way fucking more than we love the Seltzerverse.
He's got he's doing like a little eye twitch.
He's got the little twitch going. He's like, God, it's fucking dumb. the Vince thing, looking Point at it proven. From a, yeah. Proven. Looking at the Vince stuff, he was the CEO and chairman of WWE, which is it sold for what, $9.8 billion or $10.1 or whatever it was, okay? Yeah. He is now the CEO and chairman of TKO Holdings, which is a $21.8 billion business. Ooh. I don't know much about dealing and management at that level, but something tells me it's a lot more into it if your business is ultimately 2.5 times what it was worth before. Like, I have a feeling Vince is going to have a lot more on his plate now than just WWE bullshit to deal with.
100%. I feel like he hasn't really been all that. Like, the reports have been saying, like the pecking order is Triple H's baby. He does the storyline, handles it. Vince is just the last say. He's like, okay, yeah, it's final stamp of approval. You know, Triple H is kind of like the manager of the store. And Vince is now the regional manager that comes visits like maybe once a month. So like that's why he was at Raw. That was his monthly visit.
Right. That makes Bruce Pritchard the assistant to the regional manager.
It makes Vince.
I love that reference.
Jan.
Yeah.
Vince is now the Jan Levinson of the WWE universe. Jax, what's on your mind, sweet thing?
I've gotten to the point where I'm not blaming Vince. I like to blame Triple H now.
I like how excited you got about that. You're like, I like to blame Triple H now.
I do. I like to blame Steve Corino for shit a lot on NXT.
Yes, that's good.
I blame Shawn.
I don't blame Shawn Michaels.
I blame Shawn for everything.
It's all Gregory Helms' fault when shit gets fucked up on Raw.
Steve Corino and fucking Hurricane Helms. God damn it, guys.
Jamie Noble. God damn.
Well, I mean, come on. I mean, we saw the person that got fired from got fired. Dana Brooke could be possibly a reason too, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Jason Jordan.
Yep, uh-huh. Yep. Mick Foley's son. I don't know if he's still back there, but
I don't think so.
We're blaming everybody in WWE we can blame except for Vince now.
The one person I never blame is Tyson Kidd, TJ Wilson. I love that guy. Always produces great matches.
He was great. See, I think he got taken early because of injury. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I don't blame Abyss for anything. Abyss can do no wrong. Backstage.
Oh, Abyss, right. Yeah, never.
His
never.
One on TV never. Camera appearance with AJ Styles when he had like the dry erase board was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Fit Finley can never blame Fit Finley also.
Fit Finley's up there. He's great. Mick Foley for me. I'll never blame Mick Foley for anything.
No.
Fit Finley changed that women's division.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
100%. And I feel like Tyson Kidd is like stepping into that role now.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Hayes. I feel like we can blame Michael Hayes. Anybody who used to come out to the ring in a Confederate flag could be blamed.
I blame Michael Hayes for me waking up on the wrong side of the bed this morning. That's how much I blame him for things.
The only thing Michael Hayes did for wrestling is help develop the free bird rule.
Yeah.
And introduce like entrance music.
Yeah. Well, that wasn't even Michael Hayes.
It wasn't. We did.
Was it?
Gorgeous George was the first.
Gorgeous George. Yeah. Yeah. If you want to go back to Gorgeous George.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I did anything to take that away from Michael PSAs.
You know what we'll do is we'll get utensils and we'll like spoons and forks and we'll put them on jackets.
Corey Graves, just because.
Yeah, JJ says just blame Corey Graves because he's trying to take Michael Cole away from us, so we'll just blame Corey Graves for everything.
You know who I don't like? I don't like Kevin Patrick, Kilpatrick, or whatever.
KP?
I'm not a fan of KP. I feel like he's a little rough around the edges.
Him sitting between Graves and Michael Cole is the walking example of I lied on my resume and still got the job. Because he's like smiling, like, I'm just glad to be here. And he's got like two great commentators on either side.
Like, yeah, I just look at him as like Mike Tenay.
Oh my God.
He did his job, but not like nothing stands out. You know,
Mike Tenay and Don West in Impact was one of my favorite like commentary duos.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one. I like that one. They had good chemistry.
They did.
Yeah.
And then when Don West finally lost his fucking mind, I was like, hell yeah.
Now,
you got another one for us?
Yeah. According to House of Wrestling, the social media messages between Mike Santana and Ortiz exchanged over the weekend are genuine and not part of a storyline between the two. So if you don't know, Santana cut a promo and also posted that he's going solo. He posted on Twitter, part two, this comeback is personal. I paved this road. You know, the promo is really long. I'm not going to read it. But basically, you know, broke up his tag team. Ortiz responded by saying, what a way to find out years of having your back meant nothing. Good luck without your crutch. Just remember, it helped you walk for the last 14 plus years. Hope your legs are good. Thanks for being honest for once. But you couldn't say it to my face. You know you still can, right? And then Santana blasted back. Wow, first thing you said to me in 14 months. No call, no text, no call. No, I hope your recovery has gone well. But of course, paint me to be the bad guy like you've always done. Guess you forgot about our last conversation about this. Either way, I'm happy. I hope and pray the same for you.
Oof.
Gee.
Sounds like a bad relationship with no communication. Communication
is him. Yes. Is him doing it on Twitter, the wrestling version of breaking up via text?
I suppose. Well, he did it in a promo first. And then he like made a tweet.
A pre-recorded promo that wasn't on Rampage. That wasn't on AEW TV. Like, it was pre-recorded. Rampage is barely AEW TV.
Right.
What is it that people used to get IMs? That's what it is.
It's the messenger, yeah.
That's what it was. He got
Al, wasn't your AOL Instant Messenger also just a girl 918?
It was.
Holy shit, that's an old school, nice. Man. That goes all the way back to like 2000s, like early 2000s. That's how long she's had that name. I can't believe I remember that after 20 fucking years. Holy crap.
Wild.
Tim King, shout out to the homie. Tim, drop all the new info in the chat so everybody knows where to find you and everybody at the Fanatics Network. Drop all your new links. What's up, bud? Thanks for stopping by.
Tim's good people. He helped me upgrade at Collision.
Yeah.
I didn't upgrade for Collision, but for like the ROH tapings, I was able to upgrade my seats.
Nice.
So shout out to him. Appreciate it.
Shout out to Tim.
Yeah, love me some Tim King. He's always welcome here. He's one of those Chicago boys. I don't know how the fuck a good old Southern Jew like me made all my friends in Chicago, but it fucking happened, man.
You have a type.
I have a type. AJ says, what did y'all think about the Keith Lee backstage segment? What do y'all think about where Keith Lee's going right now?
Ooh.
I
think the only person that was ever able to properly book him was Triple H in NXT. I know Jax was just saying he wants to blame Triple H for everything. And I think he has something to say, so go ahead. I'll cut off.
This is a big ass callback to Ring of Honor when Keith Lee was part of Shane Taylor Promotions. This is all this is. This is, they're going to call back to when Keith Lee left Shane Taylor to go to WWE, costing Shane Taylor and Keith Lee Ring of Honor Tag Team Championship title shot.
The Pretty Boy Killers, right?
It's going to be two men that know each other so fucking well.
Tag team brothers for a long time, dude.
Yeah, two big guys that can move the way that Shane Taylor and Keith Lee move. Don't throw this away on free TV.
Yeah, no, I just hope they do something to build this off because I love Keith Lee so much. I was the NXT guy for SmackDown for such a long time, so I got to see his ascent from his debut all the way to like the moments he had at Survivor Series. The last Survivor Series here in Chicago, he was the final guy against Roman Reigns.
2019.
Yep. And
That was that bomb-ass War Games match with KO came out. Surprise entrance. Yeah. Dude, fucking pop. Dude, blew the lid off the place.
We were all there, right?
Yeah. Weren't we all there?
Yeah, I think we were all there. He was the only one to get like a serious reaction from Brock Lesnar, a worrisome reaction in the Royal Rumble. It's like, you're a big boy. You know, to see him being the double champion of NXT, then called up to Raw, be the Bearcat, flounder there, go to AEW, get so hyped for that. He should be where Adam Cole is positioned now. Him, Malakai Black, and Adam Cole should be like the three guys that should be positioned as top single guys in AEW. And that's, I feel like, the big issue right now is, like, he hasn't been. Like, they haven't even had a match with Swerve yet. So I think that's my biggest issue with the whole Keith Lee stuff. It be what it be. I just want good stuff for my big husky guy.
It be what it be.
I feel you. I think I saw what Off the Top Media said about the take was the thing that I think most people are talking about because they are like, take 22, you know? Yeah. It was kind of like, I get, like, it was supposed to be a little, like, jab joke, but, like, was it needed, though? I mean, I didn't think it was really needed, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Especially if you're not, like, going to really follow up on it, too.
Yeah.
In the segment.
You're right, Freak. You're 100% right.
Yes.
Keith, Shane, big, meaty man, yes. Slapping meat, slapping bro. 100%.
This is a reminder.
Oh, my God.
Take night on me.
It is. Hey, just remember, Bubba. Take those meds. Did everyone forget about his heart issues? He may be choosing when he wants to be in the ring. That was all COVID related, similar to what Bray was having to deal with, right?
Something like that. And I get that might be a narrative, but it's like they can still do something interesting with him. All they've done is pair him up with Dustin Rhodes. You know,
it was a mistake.
Okay.
What's up, Austin? What's up, man? How are you? Thanks for stopping by.
Shout out.
You want to know something cool about Austin Acid?
What's that?
He trained with Dustin.
Really?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, he's a Dustin student.
That's pretty dope.
I also Lucas Chase. Man, it's good to see you, Austin. Thanks for stopping by, bud. Hit that follow button while you're here. Show some love. I interviewed Lucas Chase from Dustin Rhodes Academy and shit. He can't be telling people all his secrets there, Jax.
Listen, I'll brag about that one. That one's a good one, man.
Pull the curtain back on him a little bit, man. You can't be giving the boy secrets out. Come on.
Yeah, that's company secrets.
Yeah, bro.
For his first match, it was a good
one. Oh, I appreciate that, man. Yeah, dude, I love that school. I watch a lot of their showcases on YouTube and stuff from the Dustin Rhodes. Lucas is a wonderful man. He and I follow each other on Instagram. We check in with each other every so often, see what's up. Now, you got anything for us? What's on your list?
I have lots of things. Umaga's son, Zilla Fatu, is no longer working with Booker T's Reality of Wrestling School/promotion. On his Hall of Fame podcast, Booker T said Fatu's departure was due to irreconcilable differences.
Mm.
Jax, go. It looks like you're ready to pop on this
one. How do you go from Booker T school to your next big match? Is it the Wrestle Shop in Houston, Texas? It's going to be a free show.
Yeah.
And I've been to the Wrestle Shop. It's a pony ring inside of a mall store, like a Hot Topic-sized store. Okay. I understand you got to pay your dues, man, but I would have rode the Booker T train as long as I could have.
Right.
You'd had the chance to work. You got Booker T's not only – he's got a partnership going on with NXT right now. He's bringing Axiom down. He's bringing Trick Williams down.
Oh, that's good for the NXT people.
Yeah, like, and it's – would have rode that Booker T train and just right. bit my tongue.
Yep.
Do,
same.
Do we know what the issues were? Like,
they were irreconcilable differences.
Well, I can't.
The fuck Al said.
I don't want to pull an Uncle Dave here and aimlessly speculate what the issues was. You know, we don't know what those issues were. Maybe it was something personal that, you know, Umaga-san couldn't, like, look past and decided, you know what, I'll carve my own path and do something completely different, and I don't want to have to deal with you. It could be something completely personal. Who's in the wrong, who's in the right, we'll never know. Just like the center of a Tootsie Roll pop, we'll never know.
How many licks?
One of my favorite phrases I've ever heard somebody say to me in wrestling was, they described they were talking about betting on themselves. And people in wrestling tend to bet on themselves a lot. And sometimes it goes well and sometimes it doesn't. We were lucky enough to know Lady Frost, for instance. And when her contract came up at Ring of Honor, she went into free agency. She knocked it out, killed it, and then got signed by AEW. And her husband, the Savage Gentleman, they were like, we were betting on ourselves, because both of them walked away from Impact contracts to take indie bookings, to keep building, to get that opportunity. Mm-hmm. And then she signed with AEW. So in pro wrestling, it's not always wrong to bet on yourself, but you have to know, like, when it's the time to pull that trigger. There's always going to be 1,000 what ifs, but you have to know when to go, because you can't always just rely on that same stuff, because, man, wrestling is a dog-eat-dog business. Mm-hmm. Like, lots of sharks in the water, snakes in the grass, carnies in the tent, whatever analogy you want to use. Like, it sucks, but you have to watch out for yourself in this business a bunch. Sure. Always bet on yourself. Never bet on others to help you in wrestling. It can't lie. See, Austin gets it. He pretty much, I love it when people, like, validate, so I don't look like a complete idiot. Katie says 364 licks. That seems like a very specific number, and she's OCD enough for me to believe that she counted.
Okay.
The beautiful people look good on Thursday night on Impact. I love beautiful people when they came out for I sent a picture, and it was from my buddy Justin was there, one of the 50 Justins that I know now. But he sent it to me. I was like, it's every knockout that ever competed in Impact was there for Impact 1000. It felt like.
Yeah, that's what it looked like when I was looking it up on Twitter and social media.
Yeah.
But to go with the Umaga-san thing, who knows what it could have been? Maybe it was pressure. Maybe it could have been just a differences, and who knows? But to go with Ginger Ninja said, is that, like, if you look at Booker T's track record, it's all there. The Usos, Athena, Trick Williams, a lot of them have gone on to be successful in their future. Roxanne, right. And so, I mean, who knows what could happen? I mean, I do agree with betting on yourself, but
mm-hmm.
and in Umaga-san,
he's a too. He'll be in WWE in like 2 years.
2 years.
You know,
right.
If there's anything, if there's anything that we know about the 5-2 family line, is that at some point they'll show up.
They'll be on TV. Some
they may some point. Work out, they may not, but they'll be on TV at some point.
Yep.
Two Impact things. Fightful says that Deonna Purrazzo's contract with Impact is up at the end of the year. Mm-hmm. And former WWE stars Maven and Vladimir, say his last name.
Kozlov?
There Kozlov. You go. Yeah. For backstage at Impact 1000.
Mm. Nice.
Isn't Vladimir doing movies? What are you doing? Like, isn't he been doing like movies and stuff lately?
He looks like a Bonds villain.
I think he was a villain in some movie.
Was he?
He strikes me as. I think especially now he's more chiseled now. He's got that rugged beard.
Fucking ripped.
Yeah, it looks almost as good
like
as
like a Jack's villain beard, from man. The movie Taken, like one of those.
He's doing movies. You guys know I can hear you, right? I'm sitting right here just grizzled and just ripped with my beard. Like
it doesn't compare to Jax, man. Like Jax got like a whole beard. You got a like a well groomed like, facial hair.
That's I'll just say it. Al Jax is a very lucky woman. She gets me and Jax both whenever she wants.
Yeah, Jax got a good beard.
Tech says, have a
look at it.
Now two beards.
Now two beards.
You know.
All right.
Moving on. All Out is All Out is tracking between 72,000 and 96,000 pay-per-view buys. That makes it the first AEW event that did not break 100,000 since Full Gear in 2020.
Okay. I feel like a good number of like buys that they lost out on, and I don't want to sound like a homer here, but it was in Chicago. Like, a lot of people that weren't able to go to All Out in Chicago, they were probably going to order online. But when they found out that their boy Phil from Chicago, the hometown kid, was no longer with the company, maybe that was why they were no longer there to support.
No, I mean, that's probably true.
I know, that's why I didn't watch All Out. I'm like, oh, Punk's not even going to be there.
What? And also, why am I not even going to watch? Spending $100 in 2 weeks.
He's not wrong, though.
On AEW pay-per-views, like.
Exactly. Ugh. That's another one. Yep. Uh-huh.
Yeah, I said the same thing, Austin. I said if Bill Watts had the pencil, or if Dusty Rhodes was booking this, or, you know, if Jim Crockett had a shot at it, like, they 1,000% would have been like, okay, you guys, next week in the main event, Jack Perry versus CM Punk, 1,000%, because they would have put asses in the seats. 100% they would have done.
Definitely watched, for sure.
Yeah, but, Scouts, but also, he agrees with acid. You're not wrong.
Also, mm-hmm. It does have to do with the fact that they just dropped, like, money on All In, and then now you're asking them a week later to drop mm-hmm. another, what was it, like, $50 for a pay-per-view?
Yeah, $50.
You can't do that. That's $100 on wrestling. I can't sit here and condone, especially when I just dropped $100 on Mortal Kombat. Like, my finances are tied up at the moment.
We watched it. We streamed it, dude. We streamed it in StreamYard, screen shared it and shit with, like, we had, I think, up to 6 or 7 people split each weekend so that nobody had to spend more than $20 for both shows.
Yeah.
And it was perfect. And we'll continue to do that for all the paid shows because it's easier. Plus, all of our friends live hundreds and hundreds of miles away now. Like,
yeah, it's,
you're so far away, Will.
Unfortunately. I love you. I miss you so much, Vince.
Whenever I'm in your parts. Well, right. aren't you just like 500 miles away? I could walk.
It's like an hour.
I would walk 500 miles and I
would walk 500 more.
Yeah, I could write, Vince.
I'll play it nonstop. Yeah.
We're planning a trip to Chicagoland soon.
Yeah, we're going to do a long weekend and come up there and see everybody. We're going to make it happen. Yeah. And Scal said, and mute.
I have family that lives in the burbs. So.
Oh, yeah? Where?
They live in Arlington Heights.
Oh, dude. Oh, okay. Charlie. Okay. Shout out Charlie. Charlie's around there.
Yeah. We're all everywhere.
Matt is around that area, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. They live in the same proximity as
I'm the only one that actually lives in the city.
That is also true.
What is it? 313?
312. 313 is Detroit.
312. Scout said, I'm a friend. yeah. What's up, Al?
Continuing. There's a feeling that Fox is not going for $300 million for the rights to SmackDown, and both Disney and Amazon are the two companies most in contention for it.
Oh, God.
God, no. Disney is going to water down SmackDown already than it is watered down.
They're going to ask up. Alexa to come back with that princess character. On
exactly. Exactly. The Rock showed up on Fox and he got the whole crowd to chant, "You are an asshole," to Austin Theory. And they blurred out. They censored the fuck out of it to the point where it got ruined for me. And thanks to Twitter, I was able to see the uncensored version.
Yeah.
But if Disney takes a hold of it, we're not going to get that as well. Mm-hmm. What I would love to see, and I thought this was the best setup, is that I think USA, NBC, Universal should be the home for both Raw and SmackDown. That way, we can actually have a proper brand split, and the two networks won't be sitting here like having a pissing contest over who gets who wrestler on their show. Which is how we got the whole wild card rule in the first place, because Fox wanted this wrestler. NBC Universal wanted this one on USA. Back when back when they had SmackDown and Raw on Sci-Fi/USA. I'm not saying SmackDown should go back to Sci-Fi, but both could be on USA, for instance. Like, you won't have to worry about that. That's when they had the brand split in 2016 with SmackDown Live and Raw. And it was actually a legit brand split for like a few couple years there. I think that's the answer. I think NBC Universal should just bend over backwards and just pay for SmackDown and Raw.
Yeah. I mean, my thing is like, and I know like Scout says, like, it's the FCC that keeps, that makes them, you know, but here's the thing. I feel like being able to say bitch or call somebody a bitch is worse than calling somebody an asshole. Like,
I think it's just, I think so, because I could be having a conversation with Just and he'll say something outlandish and like, bitch, Getcho.
Right.
But like, if I sit here and call him ass, like, asshole, Getcho yourself out of here. Like, it doesn't hit the same. Like, I think he'll take more offense to being called an asshole as opposed to a bitch.
You guys remember that Blink 182 song where they said all the words you're not allowed to say on the air?
Yes.
You want me to sing it for you?
Yes, go, go.
Ready?
Go.
Where he's like, bitch, cunt, fart, shit, got tucked, motherfucker. Like, yeah.
Shit,
piss, he says the C word once or twice in there. I don't want to say that.
But if they move to Prime, for example, they won't have to censor.
They won't censor, but they're going to lose that live feed.
Yeah.
And everyone has to get Prime in order to.
I want them to be on a regular network.
Yeah.
Like, right. Yeah.
I don't want to have to get Amazon Prime, even though I already have Prime Video. I don't want to have to get that if I didn't have that just to watch SmackDown.
So you're complaining about something you're not going to have to complain about when it eventually happens?
I'm complaining for those that have that issue. I'm the voice of the voiceless for the, like, the subscriber.
Oh, my God. Yes. Get out of here, CM Vince.
That is true, because not everyone has Amazon Prime. You know,
I mean, who doesn't?
Not everyone watches football too.
I do not football.
When I was doing my nerdy research, because that's what Will Gray does, I just talked about myself in the third person there. The Endeavor deal, when it took over and all of that, and it went private as TKO Holdings. Do you know who bought more shares privately or publicly than any other person or business?
Jeff Bezos.
Jeff Bezos, the guy who owns Amazon, bought more stock in TKO Holdings than everybody else. Peanut says, damn. I don't watch football unless she's talking about soccer, in which case my fucking nephew kicks balls and kicks nuts. Exactly, Scouse. Jeff Bezos.
Kick him in the nut.
Kick him in the dick. Damn. Grab his dick and twist it. Grab his dick and twist it.
Oh my God, what's man,
up, Bakley? Sorry, I didn't see you there. What's up, Bakley?
They also said that it's also being said that WWE is not married to having SmackDown on Fridays and is open to moving it to whatever night for the new rights deal. PW Insider points out that WWE and Hulu's contract extension may be about to expire as the streamer again lists WWE content, except for the past few weeks of SmackDown replay, as expiring in 10 or 11 days. So I have a feeling all of their little TV deals and streaming deals and things are about to.
I feel like a bunch of those will be renewed.
Hola, Melissa.
And, you know.
Will says hi. He knew I was talking to you when I muted myself. Defeated the whole purpose.
As far as Fox goes, like censoring and all that, they should censor some other anchorman, but whatever.
Facts.
But I'm going to say I agree with Off Top Media is that like they should all be under NBC Universal, just because NBC Universal has always had a history with working with WWE. So I think they best work.
You know what's together. The answer? You put them on Spike TV, just like TNA used to be and Raw used to be. You put them on Spike TV. That's the only reason.
What was the Raw entrance at that time? Did they have beautiful people for SmackDown?
No, I don't think it was beautiful people, but they had across the nation for Raw.
No, yes. Beautiful people was UPN.
Was that UPN still?
Yeah,
they were still on UPN.
Okay. I think I forgot which one they were using. They were using like a different like rap song, like for for
yeah, because like for a minute they had a Big Time Rush type of theme song.
Big Time Rush.
They had a Big Time Rush type of theme song. Remember, like in the 2011s, 2012s.
I think so. I stopped watching for a while there because I didn't have sci-fi on my cable provider, so I couldn't really watch a lot of SmackDown. Gotcha. So it was really only Raw for me. I Want to Be Loved. I think it's the name. There you go. I Want to Be Loved.
moving on.
I used my time.
That Will goes off the screen, but you can still hear him.
I got timed out, and I can't take myself off screen because of the one mic situation. So I just took myself off screen, so it was like I was timed out. And I was like, I'm going to hit the bong. And then I realized, like, you guys can still hear me do it.
You should just remove yourself from the screen. And
if I remove myself from the stream, then you can't hear Al because we share a mic because the way it's mixed on my computer where I record and everything. Pineapple and Pizza says Austin.
Two hosts, one mic. Put it on the show.
my safe word, pineapple.
Pineapple's my safe word too, by the way.
Don't tase me, Mr. Swap Man. Those are my quarters. You know how long it took me to acquire those?
Remember, tits out and throw away the shit.
Yeah. I did the other night too, Scout says. It's just at least see on Nerdy News, I'll just do it on screen. The rest of the shows I'll shut the camera down so you don't see me, but you still hear it.
Yeah. It's not actually like
okay.
We know what you're about, Will.
It is what it is at this point. There's no hiding it.
We know what it is.
Roman Reigns wasn't included in the initial promotional materials for next year's Royal Rumble. While he can always be added later, this still prompted speculation from WrestlingNews.com and others that Reigns might not be scheduled for the PLE in Tampa.
That's stretching it, I think.
That's for him to wrestle at Survivor Series and then not wrestle it again until WrestleMania is fucking bullshit. Even also, Bruno wrestled every 7 days.
It's not the best thing if that turns out to be the case because Roman didn't defend his title again after successfully defending against Cody until SummerSlam with Jay. And then he hasn't really been on TV all that much. He wasn't on TV all that much after WrestleMania. So that's just my whole issue is like, I don't care if you defend the title, but you need to be on screen because that's the thing that's like losing steam with this Bloodline storyline is he's not really there and it's Paul Heyman having to carry the storyline. And like, we're there for Roman. We're there to see him be dethroned. I think he will be at the Rumble, but for sure, I hope he's just there at Survivor Series. So if he's there at Survivor Series and I'm there, that's all I care about. He's not at the Rumble. I won't be in attendance, so it doesn't affect me that negatively. So I'll be okay with it.
I love you, Vince, but his ass ain't gonna be in Survivor Series. No, we'll fucking lie.
Don't put
that's
that.
That's his next scheduled match.
His next scheduled match is Crown Jewel on November 4th.
Don't put that evil on me, Allison.
I need Roman Reigns' job.
Right.
Well, I mean,
CJX, we expect you to work at least once every 7 days. Even you work more than Roman Reigns does.
Yeah.
He's wrestling at Crown Jewel, then again, maybe at Survivor Series. I haven't seen the official Survivor Series match yet.
Well, if they do War Games again, I think it'll be Judgment Day in War Games. But if they do Champion versus Champion, then he has to be there.
Right. Maybe.
Mandy Rose responded to a fan question about her returning to wrestling via her Instagram story with, "Funny you ask, your girl may or not be a free agent very soon." What do we think about Mandy Rose coming back to wrestling?
Hey, I'm for it.
Brandi Rhodes coming back to wrestling.
Oh, Brandi. Wait, Brandi Rhodes?
Oh, Brandi or Mandy?
Mandy Rose.
Mandy Rose. Oh, yeah.
Oh, I thought you said Brandi Rhodes for a second.
I thought you confirmed
her. Mandy.
Brandi Rhodes is this show's Matt Riddle.
Yeah.
Like, we don't talk about that psycho. Did I hear Mandy Rose? Mandy Rose would be hot as hell, though. He didn't hear Mandy Rose.
If I'm being honest, it's just she's getting some buzz because she's launching her OnlyFans goes live on Monday, so it's good publicity to have it. Like, she's good promotional work. She's always been open to coming back to wrestling. A lot of companies would take her. Like, Impact would hand over feet, take her right then and there. She'd be perfect. I love gingers and ninjas. We should play Fortnite with him.
Welcome. Yes, we nice. Should. I'm not that good at it, but I got a new controller.
Show her your controller. Look how cool that controller is.
It's a nice Ooh. Controller.
Yeah. I like red.
I have a busted controller.
She called me hobo. This is my all my nieces and nephews call me hobo.
We had this conversation the other night too.
It's yeah, actually, did I tell you that?
Yes, it was actually it's kind of funny. Hobo.
Hobo. All right, now what's up?
Brandon Thurston of WrestleNomics pointed out that there's a buy one, get one free promo code for tickets to AEW Grand Slam next week at Arthur Ashe Stadium. As of September 6th, WrestleTix had 6,311 tickets out for the event. Grand Slam's 2022 final count was 13,321.
Just dramatically going down.
Well, they're having a really hard time selling the tickets. Like, okay. I don't even think that they've sold like 3,000 tickets.
I heard they were having issues with scalpers too. Like, scalpers are getting their hand on those AEW tickets, and then obviously that leads to like empty seats in the arena.
Yeah, I think that's probably the biggest thing that happened at All In was. That, you know, because there was like, you know, 80,000 whatever tickets bought, but only 72,000 showed up. It's because all those other ones were bought by scalpers and then not bought.
It's Jeff Bezos protecting his new investment. He's buying off all he's the buying inventory. Yeah, it's Jeff Bezos. That's what he's doing.
And then selling them for a lower price on Amazon.
Yeah, yeah, there you go.
I mean, that's the reason why they put that whole Daniel Bryan versus Zack Sabre Jr. out like way early, right? Is that the... Is that where that match is going to be taking place at that stadium?
No.
Or is that a totally different?
No, it's at Arthur.
That's going to be in Seattle.
Yeah. Okay.
That'll be a Wrestle Dream in Seattle.
Wrestle Dream. Okay.
Yeah, this is no idea. Grand Slam to me. Is remember when?
Thank you, Scouts. WCW
did Monday Night Raw, or WCW did Nitro in
Atlanta. Yeah, the Georgia
Dome. This is what that's all Grand Slam is. It's just trying to sell out an arena for a normal TV show.
Gotcha.
That'd be like WWE doing Everbank Field here in where the Jaguars play for Monday Night Raw. It makes no sense.
Looking at the totals they're giving us, they're selling 11,000 and change. They've sold 7 of it. So roughly, you know, a little bit over 50% of the stadium has been sold. Is this going into what we were talking about with the other two shows where they booked the two big pay-per-views back-to-back and then they immediately rolled back into Dynamite, Rampage, Collision, and then immediately, like, boom, Arthur Ashe, Grand Slam out of fucking nowhere. Right. This is like their sixth big show in 6 weeks. Are they doing too much too fast?
Yes.
I think so. They do a lot of shows, and it's kind of like oversaturated. They're oversaturated because it feels like everything feels like a big show. Like they try to make everything a big themed Wednesday type Dynamite show, and it's just a regular Dynamite. It's like, I get you're trying to get ticket sales up and stuff, but I like what JJ was saying in the chat here. It's like people buy in the day of. I'm going to try to buy my Survivor Series tickets the day of because scalpers got a hold of them. I had them. I was trying to get 5. For my me, my siblings, and Melissa, the five of us were gonna go. I got up to like 3 tickets selected on the map. Then when I was gonna select number 4, number 3 disappeared. Then number 2 disappeared. Number 1 disappeared, and then everything on that row slowly disappeared. And my fucking bitches. And there were the bundles, the $300 bundles for the pre-order ones. And,
yeah,
for SmackDown and Survivor Series. I was pissed.
You I was able to get some. You get Dynamite and Rampage though, Vince.
Boo! Rampage!
Well, okay. Story time with Getcho. So we planned the Getcho thing for the Chicago Bulls game.
Right.
And we bought it way early. And Vince is like, I'm going to try to get my ticket the day of. I'm like, are you sure? And he's like, yeah. So we got like really good seats at the United Center. And Vince gets his ticket like, what was it, an hour before?
I think I bought it like an hour before.
The same day. And he has floor seats. and he paid less. And he paid less for what we paid. You're like, damn, from now on, I'm just going to buy my stuff the day of, you know.
Yeah, I think I'm just going to go to the box office at Allstate the day of, if not the day before.
We have a running tradition when we get to our seats. We'll always look up to see if we can find better available seats for less money than what we paid for ours. So we're like, yeah, those empty seats down there, like $25 less right now than what we paid for our tickets 3 months ago.
Funny enough,
I'm totally different. I buy mine fucking years in advance.
Do you?
See, I had the same idea too, Jax, but when I saw this guy paid less than how much we paid to get floor seats.
Two schools of thought. Either you're able to get it for the pre-order or the day of on the regular retail price for the show, you get peace of mind. You know you're going and you're fine, like Jax. Right. Or you get it the day of so you avoid overpriced tickets from scalpers. There's no in between anymore where you get them like a few weeks after they go live. Either you get them the day of, it's kind of like a shoe drop on the sneakers app. You got to get it right then and there. Mm-hmm. You got to make sure like it's like a last minute thing. Like
what I'm gonna start doing is, especially in Nashville, because I know they're not selling out, I'm gonna wait till keep the money back and wait till day of and buy tickets day of.
Yeah,
because like we saw literally like lower bowl seats, not on the floor but lower bowl, that were like $25 and $30 less than what we paid for ours. And we had okay seats, good, not great. And these were great seats for like $25 less a piece than what we paid for ours.
Yeah. Right. That happened to Melissa on Friday. She went to the Carol G concert over at the White Sox Stadium. Yes. She got lower bowl seats. No?
Soldier Field.
There you go. Sorry. Soldier Field.
With the Bears. Bears.
The
Bears.
So she went there, she got lower bowl seats, and then she's like, I'm pissed. There's like $300 tickets. They're like right there on the floor, like much closer than where she was.
Yeah, and like they're like Soldier Field.
Yeah, they were way cheaper than what she paid for. So it's like, buy them day of, buy them 5 minutes, you know, go to the show and get in line to check in and buy your tickets as you're on.
Buy them third match in. Buy them third match in.
Yeah, third match in. Get them in there during the pre-show card.
buy them at the semi for like $6 and a hot dog.
Buy them 0 hour. 0 hour. 0 hour.
Yeah, buy them during the 0 hour. You get a hot dog included with your purchase.
Dude, this point, like, right?
You can be like NXT and just put a list out there to go to their show for free. Which I still can't get on, and I live in Florida.
Really? Dang.
Yeah, I've been trying to get on the NXT because NXT doesn't sell their tickets. Mm-hmm. It's free. You're on a list. I've been trying now, for the past 3 months to get on this list. And once you're on it, you're gold. You're on it. You're on it for a while.
You're on all the time, right? Yeah.
As long as you don't fuck around or like no show live or stream. Stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Off the top, Scal says he's pissed at WrestleMania. Everything right now is verified resell at like 5 times the sticker price.
Yeah, that's Survivor Series right now. Yeah,
that's
We went to see Lauren Dangle yesterday, 30 minutes before the show, third row, $60.
See, look at that.
That's why I got mine as they went on sale. I'm not fucking around with Mania tickets. Bingo.
Katie,
see, you can go one side or the other with the way we're talking about getting your tickets for shows.
Those are the best ways. Get them the day of, or you get them like
as soon as they go on fucking sale.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Katie, by the way, no one has big baller money like you.
I need a banner for the Katie Foot Finder shout out. Be like, yo, follow the girl's feet, homie.
Katie's green screen should just be money.
Yeah,
for real.
She has stacks, dude. She has stacks on stacks on stacks.
Bands to make.
There's a whole show dedicated to how fucking stacked Katie is. Just money, just dollars, dollar bill, y'all. The only tickets they showed like me was Wayne four seats.
That's what I'm saying.
And he was on every day for pre-sale than regular sales. He said he couldn't get anything but four seats because how quick it sold. Mm. So, ain't that a someone a bitch?
That yeah. is a son of a bitch.
Also, too, it comes into a factor also, too, because if you're going in there with, like, a bunch of people, like, it's harder to get the seats as opposed to, like, just one seat for yourself or, like, two
That's
seats.
That's always our problem.
Because, like, I'm always trying to do, like, four or five, and, like, it's always an issue.
Yeah, that's always a problem.
We pretty much do them all in twos, and that works out well. And we always try to get close to the aisle so you don't have a bunch of, like, that way you don't have to go around and, like, that really question of etiquette, like, when you pass somebody, do you give them the ass or the crotch? Like, it's always that.
I give them a little bit of both. I try to calculate.
You go sideways and just, like, hip them? Shove them down with your hip?
No, what I meant is, like, if I know I'm going to get up at least twice during the show, I give them the crotch first and then the ass cheeks second.
I'm going to put that in a that's going to be a poll, Chad. I'm going to put it up. I'll tell you when I go. People up here on the panel, Jax, Al, Vince just kind of told us, just like, when you pass somebody in the aisle, it's a question of etiquette, man. Is it the do you go ass or crotch?
You gotta go. Well, you talk about, like, when you walk through the aisle.
Yeah,
I do the defensive, like, stance. You know, you gotta go sideways. So I guess you gotta say, you know, I guess ass. I guess
you go ass first.
I try to go, like, I try to walk it like how they do it with the police, like the drunken tyke walk.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Just so, like, they see me and I see them, so they know that, like, yo, it's time to be a gentleman or mature adult and either tuck your feet in or allow me to come in the aisle.
Yeah.
Melissa said that she goes ass to the person.
I always
she's
go
not
ass-
trying to have eye contact or kiss them or anything like that, so.
I try to go ass first because it's like a defensive maneuver, because I guess I would rather him punch me in the ass cheek than, like, punch me in the dick if he decided he wanted to, like, hand-to-hand combat me right there. Like, I'm going to, like, take it in the ass and then, like, swing an elbow or something. You heard me right, Vince. You've known me long enough to know. There ain't nothing wrong. It's 2023. You can't judge me.
I'm not judging you. It's just it always throws me off.
Austin says we're mature. We're adults. I'm a viable member of the press, ladies and gentlemen.
See, I do it that way, too, because I'm also trying to make friends on my way in the aisle. You know, hey, what's up? Try to comment on their shirt. You know, try to say something. Follow the podcast. You know what I'm saying? Try to network.
Self plug. He's plugging the shirt.
Make sure they see the shirt, the logo, you know?
What's the name of your show?
Getcho Podcast.
No, I'm just kidding. It's right on the bottom of the screen.
No, I know. I just, you know,
all the free shout outs for everybody. In case all of our boys.
You have a show? I just thought he showed up.
Jess is just here, just on occasion. Sorry. He just randomly shows up.
I could be here too.
You know. We just found him one day on the side of the road. We're like, you're ours now, Jess. You're ours now.
Okay, so I've got a few headlines about the merger. So I'm going to go through all of them and then we can discuss as a whole. A WWE source told House of Wrestling that major cuts are expected to hit the WWE's main roster and NXT talent. These cuts have been planned for a while, but it's not clear if they will coincide with the corporate layoffs that happened. Everyone at WWE who the insider spoke to everyone was on pins and needles waiting to see if they would get a call from HR telling them that they were laid off. Everyone being told to work from home added the sense of unease, especially since it's not like they will even get a chance to personally return and say their goodbyes and pick up their property. Multiple divisions in the company were absolutely ripped apart because of these cuts. For example, the insights and analytics team of 20 plus people now only has 3 employees left. WWE fired more than 100 employees during Friday's mass layoff. One of which
was Will Gray. I'm no longer paid for by a Connecticut payroll check.
One of which is reported to be Dana Warrior, who led the Warrior Foundation. So that makes that's interest. I'm curious to know what they're going to do with that now.
The self-destruction of the Ultimate Warrior Part 2.
As far as roster cuts go, they it's being said that Elias is just without a professional contract at the moment, but he's still with WWE.
Yeah, his contract expired from what I heard.
That's me. My professional contract expired, and now I'm just like there. Yeah. Do they change the Warrior Award to the Cena Award since Dana Warrior was released? I would probably say Cena would be the next one in charge because he does all the Make-A-Wish Foundation stuff, right?
If
they renamed it.
It should be the Cena Award. The only issue is that no one would be able to see the award.
I was about to say they can make it like a clear, like crystal sculpture so you don't really see anything. You're not really sure what it
cap.
Is.
It's yeah. a baseball cap.
I was going to say knuckles, just the knucks. The Shad Gaspard Award would be a good pick, Katie. Good eye. Scowls agrees. I mean, there's lots of good options if they wanted to rename that award. I think they had people they could go to.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot. I mean, I never was really in favor of naming it the Warrior Award. I mean, I know they were using the name Warrior for what the actual word Warrior stands for in association to Ultimate Warrior. But, yeah, I was never, like, cool with it actually looking like Ultimate Warrior's mask, you know.
Yeah. So I want to play a quick little game that I didn't tell Will I wanted to do, but it won't take very long.
Real quick before you start, passing somebody at a show, a question of etiquette, do you pass with the ass or the crotch? Everybody said ass. Everybody agreed that the best way to do it is with the ass. So give them the ass at a wrestling show. That is here. That is democracy. Shall, it's your show. Al, it's your show. Shall, it's your owls.
Okay. So I want everybody to pick one male and one female from the entirety of the roster to future endeavor. Like, who would be your choice to give the act? One male, one female. Jax?
Why you pick me?
Because you're next to me.
Okay. To future endeavor, Jinder Mahal.
Oh, that's a good pick.
And for my female, it's so hard because you don't want a future endeavor somebody with they need all the female wrestlers they have.
Do they?
No, they really don't. Valhalla. That's
a good answer.
That's a good answer.
Like, I understand why she's back, but at the same time, she could go away and it wouldn't
make a difference.
Make a difference in the action.
Just.
For the male, it's hard. I mean, they really let go of Kona Reeves, right?
Who?
Kodo Reeves. Remember Kodo Reeves? No. Yeah, they already let go of him. For the women, I kind of like. I'll give my future endeavors to Natty Neidhart.
Ooh, that's a ballsy move, Jess.
You know,
or would just put her backstage?
I would probably send her to coaching in NXT. You know, just like to help with the both divisions, not just the women, but male and male and female to help with their division. I mean, she's at that state now where I think that's what she's utilized for anyway. So that's what I would just like give her that role as a coach. Cause I feel like that's what she really is, she's more of a coach than an actual like wrestler performer. But that's just me. I think she's best suited as a coach.
Katie says Riddle and Valhalla. She was real quick to throw that in there without question. We know why Riddle. I'm pretty sure I understand why Valhalla.
Yeah.
She does nothing for a division.
Yeah.
The Valhalla too. Yeah.
Vince, I'm assuming you're next just by process of elimination.
Sure. Well, I mean, personally, me, I never want to sit here and speculate who would or should be future endeavored or just lose their job, because I never want to like sit here and advocate for someone to lose their job. But just to go on script, off gimmick, and play up with everything that I've been saying this whole time, I'm going to go ahead and say Matt Riddle. I'm going to agree with Katie, you know, Ritter over Riddle. And as for the female division, I'm going to go to Nia Jax. I think that's the perfect answer. No, she hasn't done anything.
She just showed up.
We won't miss her. She's already been gone. You know?
Right. Yeah. Now, she showed, how'd you get fired on your day off? Like,
Will.
I'm going to give, I'm going to go with a really, it's going to be a unique choice here. I'm going to go with Ali. Because I think if they future endeavored Ali, he'd have a chance to go do like the G1 or the best of the super dupers over in the ICUP league or whatever.
Super dupers.
Best of the super dupers. we could see him in AAA, go down in CMLL and piss off the Mexican cartels, all kinds of things. If you
don't
want to
do that,
no.
But I think I would release Ali so he could go be in. I would love to see him in the best of the super dupers.
And he would be booked well.
Yeah, he would. He would immediately get booked.
Yes.
Women, it's a little bit tougher in the women's division. I want to go with Valhalla because I agree. She doesn't do anything for the division. But I think somebody, if she got released, who would immediately get picked up and made a star anywhere she could go. And almost for the same reason that I said Ali. Now, with what's going on in their women's division when I say it, Asuka. Let Asuka go and send her back to Japan now that Stardom's so big, now that the ICUP has the International Junior Women's World title or whatever it is, like the Japanese fan fiction stuff. So, I don't know. Like, I say Ali and Asuka so they can go back to New Japan.
If you future endeavor Tamina, you can maybe get Mercedes. You can get Trin and Tamina all on Impact to reunite Team Bad.
Sure. Kevin Patrick and Tamina. Cool. AJ says, get rid of KP and Tamina.
Oh, I didn't know we can go with commentators. I get rid of Kevin Patrick. Can I do Kevin Patrick and Nia?
Yeah, Kevin Patrick and Nia. one more before we hit the road.
I would future never who was ever making the current music.
That's the answer.
I have two more after I say who. One so my female would be Ronda Rousey.
Yeah.
Yeah. And because honestly, I don't think she does anything for that women's division except bring it down. And then. Mm-hmm.
But she's gone already, isn't she?
I think she's gone, but she hasn't officially been released from a contract or anything.
She's just gone.
She's just on a break. Oh, got it. Whatever. Okay. She hasn't been officially, like she's still listed as on the roster.
Oh, I see. She hasn't gotten her FedEx in the mail yet. For waiting for her wedding
on her
day.
Wedding day. On her wedding day.
Damn.
So... and then my male would be, I would say Riddle because of just all the controversy that he is causing. I think it's probably just best that they just cut ties.
Yeah.
We're talking all promotions, right? Or just
WWE? No, I think just WWE.
Oh, Jack Perry.
Rousey is overrated. Reasons. Somebody who doesn't watch the product says Rousey is overrated. So that tells you what Rousey's stock is like outside the wrestling world. Like people who don't watch wrestling or MMA say she's overrated.
I thought she ruined Mortal Kombat 11 by voicing Sonya Blade. And Sonya Blade's one of my favorite characters. She ruined her.
How do you feel about Jean-Claude Van Damme being in MK1?
Cool. That's a nice little Easter egg. They've been trying to get him forever.
Since the original one, right?
Yes. He was going to be the sole motivation for Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
Shout out to Megan Fox being the voice of Nataro.
Yeah.
Big shout out to... Just shout outs to everybody. Tonight's the free shout out episode.
Yeah. It's the Oprah episode. You get a shout out. You get a shout out. Everyone gets a shout out.
Everybody gets a fucking shout out tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Al?
So, a couple of things left. EW sources indicate to PW Insider, AEW sources indicate to PW Insider that Jade Cargill's contract could expire as soon as this week. AEW has had contract negotiations with her, but a new deal has not been reached. There are people in AEW who believe she will be leaving as a free agent to join in WWE's NXT brand.
I heard through the grapevine on Twitter that's what I mean by the grapevine, that she's scheduled to be at the Performance Center this upcoming week. So,
I mean, she may just be there for like a little look-see, though.
Yeah, a little cup of coffee. You know, check out the scene.
A little dirty chai. A little dirty chai.
See what they have to say. Dirty chai. I love what they have to offer. So I know we touched on this earlier. I would love to see Bianca versus Jade. Yeah. I think that would be fucking fire.
You know which would be a great matchup for Jade as well? That's on SmackDown. I say she should go to SmackDown. Charlotte Flair versus Jade Cargo. That would be a great
matchup. That would be really fucking good too.
Mm-hmm. Do you think she goes main roster immediately?
Yes. Yeah, oh, 100%. She'll go to the Performance Center. She'll try out. She'll get approved by the doctors. And I don't think there's any way they send her to NXT. That will be a waste.
I agree.
Yeah. If it was someone like Chris Statlander or Thunder Rosa, I feel like, yeah, they'd get that NXT run.
Just but to get the WWE playbook. Just yeah, to get with WWE, but yeah,
Jade's getting that AJ Styles treatment,
or she goes to NXT and beats Becky Lynch.
That would be huge for Jade to show up and beat Becky Lynch on night one.
Or she has a seven star Tokyo Dome against Lash Legend on NXT.
Yeah, that too.
Not
less. You never know.
Or you know, a PWI worthy against Electro Lopez.
There you go. Shout out Electro Lopez.
My last thing, and then my last thing that I always do. Matt Menz, Andrew Zarian, is confident in saying that AEW will be on Max in 2024, and AEW will expand its pay-per-view schedule to 12 a year.
If they do the WWE Network model where it's like you just pay for the subscription, you have to pay additional money for the live pay-per-view, then yeah, I think it'd be a good venue, because I hate using the Bleacher Report app to try to fucking watch an AEW show. It's terrible. I had a terrible experience with it for All In, and I've continuously had terrible experiences with it. I have not a single good experience with it, so I think they should be on the streaming app if you want me to watch your pay-per-views more often. So if they go on HBO Max, I already have it, so easy peasy. No harm there, you know? I think they should do that. If not HBO Max or Max or whatever, it should be some kind of streaming platform. Fuck it, put them on Peacock.
Yeah. Peacock? a new segment that I have started is our Ryback Tinfoil Hat Moment of the Week. I've recently started following this man on TikTok, and it is something.
It's a trip.
It's something. It's
it's something. I think I'm like one of 10 people in the IWC that's not blocked. But
I'm not blocked.
On the Ryback show, Ryback says he smells like meat 24/7. So he's always worried that security dogs at the airport will try to bite him.
Oh my God.
Yeah, he pulls his pork.
He pulls his pork? He just shoves fucking pulled pork into his pockets. He's like, I can't wait for TCS or whatever the fuck they're called to get
find my meat, man.
Yeah, dude. He hasn't blocked me. Scouts is so hyped. Meat? JD joined the Rivet City Radio Hall of Fame and blocked one of the members of the team. So JD from New York, fuck you. JJ ran. I had one issue with Bleacher Report and it ran fine for me. Could it be because I ordered the day of? See, day of buying is always a better option than buying it.
There you go. What did he say? What type of meat are we talking about? Are we talking prime rib?
He didn't talking, say.
New York strip.
He just smells like salami. Meat.
Capicola.
Capicola.
Is it a good aged meat, like in a smokehouse?
I mean, there you go. It probably smells like
charred brisket.
I love brisket,
so,
bro.
Here's what I think Ryback smells like. You know when you get the meat sweats when you go to a Brazilian steakhouse and just eat too much? I feel like that's probably what Ryback smells like.
Hell yeah.
Dude. Meat sweats.
Yuck.
Take a shower.
I showered yesterday.
Ryback does not a shower, you know.
Ryback doesn't have to shower. Like, he just walks outside and Mother Nature does her thing.
Right. I shower when it rains.
Fun fact, Ryback is willing to go live with anyone on TikTok.
Yes.
As long
yes.
as you have live privileges. You just got to wait in line.
I'm trying so fucking hard to get in there because he has me blocked on every major social media except for TikTok right now, and I'm trying really hard to get it. But I want to go live with him. And he said my name twice in lives, but he's like, who's next? Okay, Twinkle Toes user 4766.
Yep. Like, I promise you, this man has a list on his wall of every fucking person he has blocked on Twitter. I mean, he just like writes it on his walls, and his entire wall is covered with all of the usernames of people he has blocked.
You remember Steve Buscemi's character in Billy Madison?
Yes.
Where he's got like the list of the snipes. Yeah, that's Ryback at home. He's just filling with the list, and he's like,
and then he puts lipstick on. He puts lipstick on.
He's like, I'd fuck me. Ryback like tucks it back, and he's like, I'd fuck me good.
Like, real good, boy. Feed me more.
The only good thing about Ryback is just his impression of him on the Getcho Podcast.
Is Ryback, how you doing?
Ryback, no? How you doing?
All right. See you later.
All right, gentlemen. I guess we made it. The Getcho takeover is done. But before we go, we have to plug ourselves live on air. So, Jess, I'm going to give you the pleasure of plugging yourself first.
All right. Well, if you like my takes and some of my jokes, then you can find me in the Getcho Podcast on the Twitter, Getcho Podcast on Instagram. You can't find me there. You can also find me with Marks and Mikes. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Check out our new episode. We did a Mortal Kombat if wrestlers have fatalities. So that was pretty dope. Yep.
That's a good sweaty session right there.
It was very good. Matt had a sweaty session, even though he wasn't actually in attendance for the episode, and probably had the best one.
What was it?
Oh, you gotta have to listen to the episode.
It was a Stone Cold fatality. I'm not gonna give.
No, not Stone Cold. It was the Hulk Hogan one.
It's in the episode. I thought you were saying Matt had an idea for a sweaty session.
No, he had a sweaty session to add to our sweaty session.
Hell yeah. Papi Delgado?
Sure. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter at SCS Vince. The link to my bio takes you to everything Straight Talk, Smack the Raw, Getcho Podcast, The Works. Like Jess said, we just recently did a Getcho episode, so go ahead, check that out. Smack the Raw Podcast, we just recently did our episode live stream last night. The episode should be up soon at some point when Travis gets to it. Curtain Call, episode 50. Haven't been able to get around to it due to work constraints and stuff like that, but I'm going to get it booked by the end of the weekend. I feel like I've been saying that for the last 2 weeks, but you know, follow me on Spotify, turn on the bell notifications so you know when we go live with the episode. Just search up SCS Vince, you'll find it. We talk Pokemon with Will and Matt, and we also talk NBA jerseys with Jalen on the beat and my co-host Basharat, and final episode, so check it out.
You know, I got a number 9 Boston Celtics jersey for Rajon Rondo.
Ooh.
Yeah. Rondo versus Rose was a good battle.
It's a green with white letters, yeah. I think it was the home alternate at the time.
Nice.
Well, you wear your number 9 jersey, and I will wear my number 6 Bulls jersey, and together we can be a 69.
Yeah, papi. Todos días. Jaxbo, tell us what's going on with you.
There's a lot going on, so I'll make it short and sweet. Follow me on the Twitter for every show that I'm on. And I'm here every Sundays for Botched and Chair Shots. Nerdy News at 420, which is so much fun.
Love that show.
City Radio. Wrestle Talk Wolfpack and Boyfriend Time. And I'm dropping some news on my Twitter about a new show I will be doing coming very soon. I'll be dropping that news tomorrow.
Hell's yeah. Al?
Oh, and NXT on taps. Sorry.
NXT on tap.
You can find me at justagirl918 on the Twitters, Instagram, and the Tiki Talkies. Tomorrow, I will be posting a challenge for my birthday. I am going to post Will's outro, and I want people to stitch it and try to either replicate it or do their own version. Ooh. So.
Okay.
That'll be fun.
Can't wait to see it.
On my end, the housekeeping stuff, as always, first and foremost, always my shout outs. Follow Off the Top Media, follow Creation World, follow the Fanatics Network and the Bloodline Network. Follow World Championship Breakage, the Wrestle Talk, Wolfpack. Follow all my friends. If you have Discord and want in, hit the link in the bio. It'll take you to the Off the Top and Rivet City Radio Discord. Follow Katie Kinsey and the She Elite Showcase. Click the link in the bio for the Discord. That's your direct link to all the hosts and producers and all that nonsense. If you're a merch type person and you want that sweet Botch Bots and Chair Shots merch, cop it at angrylemonade.com/BotchBotsandChairShots. I say it every week. Jeff Bezos has too much money. If you have Amazon Prime, give it to somebody who matters. That's us. That's the Wolfpack. That's Creation World or Vince. Give it to anybody else as long as Amazon doesn't get it. The lifeblood is always patreon.com at Rivet City Radio. That's the Hill Support Group. That's the Raw Rewind. That's Botch Bots and Chair Shots After Dark. That's all of that starting on Tuesday with the new show I'm rolling that's food related. There's going to be lots of Patreon exclusive content there. That's it, really, guys. If you guys don't have anything for the class, I'm going to wrap it up.
Never wrap it up.
Watch the table spot after we go off the air.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I always the schedule. Table spot's about to come on. They're going to roll about 9:30 Central Time. Mondays, we've got paying dues right after Raw. We've got a new show rolling next week after that. Tuesday is Nerdy News, NXT Live on Tap. We've got Botch Bots and Chair Shots After Dark this week. We're doing an episode about Test. Wednesday is the Boom with Cam G. Tons of content on Rivet City Radio, 7 days a week. I just did that without the notes, just off the top of my head from memory.
Look at that.
Dude, we got a ton of shit going out. Watch the content, do all the things. Anybody got anything for the class before I talk real fast?
Love you, Will.
No.
I love you, Poppy. It was great to see you and Jess, as always.
Love Rivet City Radio.
Love you guys. But now, as we close another episode of Botched Podcast, share shots, take a minute, thank you for listening. Remind you to go wherever you do anything on the internet, like, follow, subscribe, unsubscribe, then subscribe again. Leave a comment telling me how great I am or how beautiful Jax's beard is. Either way, it helps the algorithm and helps find new listeners. If you're really generous, head over to patreon.com and donate to the Rivet City Radio Podcast Network. You get some fantastic swag. We get some fantastic guests. It's a win-win. Para mi papi Delgado y mi amigo Jess for my favorite ginger ninja, Jax Bow, and for the boss bitch, Al, I am V. Will Gray. Thanks for stopping by and listening, my people.
Bye-bye.
Later.